Do you remember who Jon Snow was? Which discovery did he do in 1849? He was the first one reporting that the cholera epidemic was attributed to the consumption of non-disinfected well water. Welcome to the drinking water treatment lecture about disinfection. My name is Luc Rietveld and I'm a professor in urban water technology. During this lecture, I will explain you why we use disinfection, some theory about disinfection, and which different types of disinfection methods exist. Nowadays, we know that many pathogenic microorganisms are present in water, which enter the water through feces from humans and animals. Pathogens can cause various health risks, which may become epidemic when spread through drinking water supply. The pathogens can be divided into three main groups, each with their own individual characteristics: protozoa, bacteria, and viruses. With disinfection techniques, these pathogenic microorganisms can be inactivated or removed. Another objective of disinfection is the prevention of regrowth of opportunistic microorganisms in reservoirs and distribution systems. Microorganisms are eliminated by disinfection following different steps. First, the chemical disinfectants oxidize or rupture the cell wall. Subsequently, the disinfectants can enter into the cell by means of diffusion. And finally, they damage the DNA so that the microorganisms cannot replicate and or die. Different models have been developed to describe the disinfection kinetics. The two most important are Chick's law and Watson's law. If those two are combined, the Chick-Watson equation is obtained. The natural logarithm removal of pathogens is thus assumed to be linearly proportional to the so-called CT value, which is the product of the concentration of disinfectant in the reactor and time. Chemical disinfectants are oxidants reacting with components in the water. Therefore, the concentration of the disinfectant declines in time, which should be taken into account when calculating the real CT value. The CT value is used as a basis for estimating the degree of disinfection. So, for a requested inactivation, a certain CT value is required. On this slide, you see an overview of the required CT values and the IT values, which is the product of the intensity of UV light and exposure time for various microorganisms per type of disinfectant for a log-2 inactivation. If free or combined chlorine is used as disinfectant, which is formed when chlorine reacts with ammonia or organic nitrogen, a low CT value is required for viruses and E. coli, while for protozoa, Cryptosporidium parvum and Giardia, a high CT value is required. For UV radiation, it is the other way around. A higher IT value is required for viruses compared to protozoa. Besides the type of microorganism, the kinetics of disinfection also depends on the type and concentration of disinfectant, the temperature — with a lower temperature, the disinfectant is less effective — and the pH. The lower the pH, the more effective chlorination is. The efficiency of the disinfection method depends on the disinfection kinetics and the matrix of the water, as for example, the presence of natural organic matter or ammonium, because these substances also react with the disinfectant. I will now introduce to you different types of disinfection techniques. Chlorine is the most widely used as disinfectant, since it is the easiest to operate and the least expensive disinfection technique. It is applied as chlorine gas or as sodium hypochlorite liquid or powder. When chlorine gas is used, it dissolves in water and hypochlorous acid is produced. Depending on the pH, hypochlorous acid is dissociated into hypochlorite. In this figure, you can see the distribution of chlorine gas, hypochlorous acid, and hypochlorite for different pH values. All three chlorine components act as a disinfectant, but hypochlorous acid has a better disinfection properties compared to hypochlorite. When chlorine is added to the water, it doesn't only disinfect microorganisms, it also reacts with organic compounds, as said before. This can result in the decrease of free available chlorine and the formation of harmful disinfection byproducts, such as trihalomethanes and haloacetic acids, which are carcinogenic. The disinfection byproducts can be avoided by removing the natural organic matter, for example, from the water by coagulation, activated carbon filtration, or ion exchange, or avoiding high dosages. Furthermore, chlorine can react with inorganic compounds. Ammonium can be removed by chlorination. This phenomena is called breakpoint chlorination, shown in this figure. At this point, all the ammonium is converted into monochloramine via the reaction shown on the slide. The free chlorine is thus converted to what we called combined chlorine. When additional hypochlorous acid is added, it reacts with the monochloramine, and at this point, the breakpoint, the reaction is over and all the ammonium is removed. The concentrations of chlorine used for ammonium removal are quite large. Therefore, nowadays, we use other methods to remove ammonium, for example, biological filtration. Or we avoid the discharge of ammonium in water bodies by extensive sewage treatment. The main advantage of chlorine is that it provides a residual and can thus be used as transport chlorination to prevent regrowth in the distribution system. However, the use of chlorine has also some downsides. It is, for example, less effective for protozoa. In addition, since it is a strong oxidant and extremely corrosive, special storage and handling measures should be taken. The other disadvantage is the already mentioned formation of disinfection byproducts. Therefore, chlorination is no longer applied in water treatment in the Netherlands. Various alternative disinfection methods exist. An alternative chemical disinfectant process is ozonation, and examples of physical processes are UV radiation, slow sand filtration, managed aquifer recharge, and membranes. Ozone is generated from oxygen present in air or in pure oxygen gas. Due to its instability, ozone should be generated in situ and requires a high level of maintenance and operational skills. The initial investment costs for equipment are also relatively high. Ozone is more effective than chlorine for inactivation of protozoa, and short contact times are required. However, when bromide is present in the water, the disinfection byproduct bromate is formed, and ozone doesn't maintain a residual level in the distribution system. Also for UV disinfection, expensive equipment and specific operational skills are required. Just as ozone, UV is more effective than chlorine for the inactivation of protozoa. The biggest advantage of the method is that, as far as we currently know, no disinfection byproducts are formed. Slow sand filtration is a simple process to operate, but relatively expensive to build because of the large footprint. Slow sand filtration removes the microorganisms from the water by filtration, sieving, adsorption, and decay. It is also effective in removing microorganisms as the other chemical disinfectant method and can reach 99% to 99.9% of removal percentages. An advantage is that disinfection byproducts aren't formed, but it also lacks the formation of a residual to prevent regrowth. This is, however, compensated by the high degree of nutrient removal during the process, also diminishing the regrowth potential. To obtain sufficient disinfection in the Netherlands, several types of disinfection methods are placed in series to obtain sufficient and a more reliable removal of microorganisms. This is what we call multi-barrier system. In disinfection, we generally use the log reduction value, also called the decimal elimination capacity, to express the efficiency of the multi-barrier system. The log reduction value is the logarithm of the incoming concentration minus the logarithm of the outgoing concentration, which is the same as the logarithm of the incoming concentration divided by the outgoing concentration. 2 log removal is equivalent to 99% removal, and 4 log removal is 99.99% removal. As an example, a multi-barrier system is shown. First ozonation and then slow sand filtration. The incoming number of E. coli per liter is 1.2 million. And the outgoing concentration of the ozone treatment steps is 478 per liter. The log reduction value is then 3.4. If you also calculate the log reduction value for the slow sand filtration, you can determine the total log reduction value by adding both numbers, which is, in this case, 4.1. During the surface water treatment lectures, you learned about the difference between completely mixed and plug flow reactors. Plug flow tanks are more efficient in the removal of pathogenic microorganisms than completely mixed reactors. Short circuiting should also be avoided, since it has a negative effect on the efficiency of disinfection. Here you can see an example of the dramatic effect of only 1% bypass on the total log reduction value of the system. It decreases from 3.4 to 2. This shows that not only a sufficient disinfectant dose is important, but also a proper design is required. When chlorine is used as disinfection, the residual chlorine prevents regrowth in the distribution network. When using alternative disinfection methods, the water should be biologically stable, avoiding regrowth in the distribution system by nutrient limitation. Multi-barrier systems can ensure the production of such a high quality water. Furthermore, the transport and distribution system should be strictly maintained to prevent leakages, and the system should be continually pressurized. In the Netherlands, we therefore only allow chlorination in water in swimming pools.